Hi there, it's Freeman Stephen. It's Thursday, the 5th of June 2014. I am not an anarchist. I'm not offended at the fact people might think I am, because I do have an awful lot of views which I share with anarchists. And I would even say there's some people who would describe themselves as being anarchists who are perhaps less anarchistic than me. But I'd still say I'm not an anarchist, because I do believe that there is some value to be had from having a ruling class. And that's really what anarchy is really about. It's the people who, like an anarchist society, well, it's described as being chaotic and lawless by some people. I'd say that's not entirely it's not entirely the truth, but there are slight grains of truth in it. But what an anarchist society really is a society that does not tolerate a ruling class. So archy, as in hierarchy, monarchy, oligarchy, these type of things are not acceptable within anarchy. So anarchy is basically no archy, no acceptance of any form of ruling class whatsoever. You might describe them as being archons when you consider what a monarch is or what an oligarch is, or these various different types of archy. They describe them as being archons, but I think there are like metaphysical sort of aspects to what an archon is as well. And to be quite honest with you, I think there's I'm very much at the edge of what people can handle with the things that I speak about, and I really just avoid. You'll never hear me talking about any metaphysical aspects on my videos, because I realise that people have enough problems trying to cope with the type of information that I'm telling them about what's going on in the material world, to start going on about the metaphysical world. It could really, it's quite a dangerous territory to get into, so I'm not going to go into kind of like archons in any sort of metaphysical area whatsoever. So just to kind of deal with the material aspect, so I'm not an anarchist, because I do believe there is some value to having a ruling class of some description. I would say an anarchist proper would be someone who does not tolerate a ruling class under any circumstance whatsoever. And I must say that though I would tolerate a ruling class, the circumstances would be very, very specific, and it would have to be like voluntary, so that the actual people who are being ruled over are choosing to be ruled over voluntarily and consensually, not in the sense of their consent's implied by things that they do before they even know they're doing it, kind of thing, or by virtue of the fact that they don't leave a specific territory the moment they're born, or any bullshit like that. What I mean is like a ruling class where people decide like, it'd be good to have a leader, therefore we select you to be our leader and we agree to be ruled by you. That to me, I'd say the voluntarist views overrule my anarchist views, to say that if people do want to be ruled over, if they do genuinely consent to being ruled, then I don't have any right to say we're not allowed to be ruled. But I wouldn't extend that kind of really that view of that tolerance of ruling classes, people who want ruling classes, I wouldn't extend that to say that just because like Joe, John, Mary and Karen wants a ruling class to rule over them, that ruling class should then rule over other people who do not, like, voluntarily, willingly, knowingly consent to being ruled. So that's where I would kind of draw the line there. So I am anarchist to, like, a great extent, but not totally anarchist to the point of view where I would say, well, you're not allowed to be governed, because even if you want to be governed, what I'm saying is, like, if you want to be governed, that's up to you. I don't have any right to stop you from doing that. I wouldn't say, like, I don't know about myself. I'd think that maybe that the idea of, like, having a government, it does have advantages. I mean, certainly not these systems that we live in today. The only kind of advantages that you get is the fact that they're not going to batter you if you don't. Do you know what I mean? The only advantage is that they're not going to be throwing you in a cage kind of thing if you agree to be governed by them. And that's really no advantage. That's kind of like me walking up to you with a gun saying, like, give me all your money, and then calling it an advantage of the fact you haven't been shot. Do you know what I mean? In the first place, I should never have been, like, aggressing against you in the first place. So certainly no advantage in the truest sense of the word. But that's kind of these kind of systems of governance that we live in today kind of thing. I would say, like, no, definitely not that type of thing. And if we're limited to those systems of government, then yeah, okay, I'm an anarchist kind of thing, you know, but I'm not so anarchist that I couldn't tolerate the idea that everybody must be individualist to the point where they're not allowed to have a leader even if they want one kind of thing. And that's how I see a proper anarchist society would be like, that people would be restricted by the law that would exist through the that seems a bit odd to some people that the law would exist within anarchy. And I'm going to try and explain that for anybody that doesn't quite get it. How is it possible that a law could exist when there's no ruling class to make a law? I suppose the best approach I can take to kind of explaining this is that there's a law, a government made law, let's call that statute, right? There's a statute in Scotland where if you're walking a dog and the dog does a shit, then you've got to pick up that shit and dispose of it. You can't just leave it in the grass, and it's against the statute for you just leave that shit in the grass if you've walked your dog and your dog has done it kind of thing. And if you don't pick up your dog's shit and dispose of it, then you're going to be you'll be forced to hand over some number of hours that you've worked, depending how high up you are in the social hierarchy. You'll maybe have like an hour of your time docked by the government, or 10 hours of your time. Like, the fine's the same for all people, regardless of how long it takes or me earn that kind of money. And if you don't pay the fine, then you end up getting thrown in a cage. So that is kind of a law made by government, right? And that is what I describe as a statute. And I think people can see the reason. I don't think anybody would dispute it's a statute, but they would say maybe I'm telling a half-truth here, because there's some other law that hasn't been made by government. And whether you want to call it the law or not, there's a thing called that I'm going to describe as the moral law, or just to get away from that word law altogether to prevent any bias creeping in here, what I'm trying to say. It's just basically morality. And I would say that morality is like overarching, so that even the statutes are kind of like, to some extent, actually bound to be moral. to some extent, I realise that sometimes like morality is misused as justification for a statute. And I would say like, that whole like dog poop law is like, a good example. I've chosen that example for this specific reason. Now, I don't know, I could kind of speculate why that law, why that statute was introduced. But it certainly has moral justification, and I suspect that the moral justification is a bit contrived, but nonetheless, my point is that that statute would not, at the present, the types of systems of governments that we've got, it would not be acceptable to pass that through legislation, because we do have people who, to a great extent, are moralistic, if manipulated, who are within the system and working in the system, and in order to get a law, a statute passed through, you have to pass it by these people's eyes first, and that can be a complicated thing to do if there's no moral justification for the law. So the idea of creating a statute saying like everybody must slaughter the firstborn before a statue of the king tomorrow, like a statute like that is never going to get passed through because of everybody having some sort of adherence to this thing that's not the moral law, that because people are moralistic and there's moralistic people within government, any sort of like statute that's getting passed needs to have moral justification. So if we're talking like statutory law and moral law, the moral law is the overarching thing, that the sort of real powers of the world, the folk that kind of like start wars and like do these various things which are immoral, it's kind of like an obstacle that they have to overcome. So you end up having like statutes which are justified by the moral law in like, very contrived ways. Now that specific dog poop law, the moral justification for that is that if like, a dog shits in the park and a child decides to start playing with that shit and then touches, and the child touches its eyes, there are circumstances which can exacerbate and lead to the child being blind, kind of thing. Now, this, I'm sure it does happen, kind of thing, you know, it can happen, but it was like a very few and far between case, even for children that have touched dog shit. Just at the time this law was being, this statute was being introduced, that was just kind of like on the television all the time, you know, in every newspaper. Child goes blind because of, but like dogs had been shitting in parks for thousands of years. They were shitting in the fields and people and children had been playing with it for years, and an occasional one going blind through it. Most of them like not touching dog shit. But the ones that were not all in were going blind, but you never heard anything about it until somebody decided to the need to prevent dog shits from being there in parks for some reason, and the way they did it was to provide the moral justification in the way of what children may be blind for this. And if you use this law, this new statute that we're introducing, then you're in favour of blinding children. And often that's the way a lot of these things are imposed, is, oh, it's for the good of the children, you know, and you must be anti-children if you think there might be some sort of other reason for this law being introduced. I can really only speculate about the reasons. It could be something as simple as just somebody that doesn't like the look of dog shit on the grass, but it could be like the kind of like the saltpeter content or something like that, which could enable like mere peasants access to exposures or whatever through just like harvesting what lies in nature, kind of thing. But I mean, this was coming in at the same time as Thomas Hamilton went with a gun to a school in Dunblane and started killing children. You know, in the same way, you've got these kind of things happening at Sandy Hook in America today, and all of a sudden, for some reason, there's a lot of nutters going about killing masses of people with guns, and new laws are trying to get proposed and they're trying to push through new laws and. You could call me a conspiracy theorist, but it wouldn't surprise me if Thomas Hamilton was not, in fact, put up with it, put up to do to kill those children, but the very people who wanted those kind of anti-gun laws introduced, because basically they were trying to implement the sort of totalitarianism that we're in today, and they knew that people having the access to guns that they used to have. It would have made it a very difficult thing for them to get away with doing what they're doing. So you can call me a conspiracy theorist if you want, but I'm kind of getting off at a tangent here. I'm trying to go on about what I'm meaning by law and lawlessness and stuff like that. So if you want to say that the law is whatever the government says the law is. Then yeah, the anarchy is a lawless system because there is no government, and there is no ruling class to say this is the law or that is the law. But if you want to look at the law as being the moral law, as in people don't steal from each other and people don't kill each other, then it's the totalitarian, the governmental, the statist system. Which is like the state-based systems, which are the lawless things. Because what you've got, really, if it's just whatever the government says it is, what you end up having is like this moral law, and then the ruling people, basically declaring themselves exempt from the moral law, saying well, we're going to make sure no one kills people by ensuring we're the only people that are allowed to kill people. Now we'll all be against the law if somebody walks up to you with a gun and says, "Give me a certain percentage of the fruits of your labour, or I'm going to hurt you," kind of thing. And the way we're going to do that is by raising taxes, which in effect is the exact same thing. Basically, there is the whole system. If you consider the law to be the moral law. Then the whole kind of the ruling class kind of systems that pervade today are lawless to the extent that the ruling class declare themselves to be exempt from that moral law, but they declare that the protection of the moral law is the reason they're exempt from the moral law, which is as contradictory as what it sounds as far as I'm concerned. But it actually breeds lawlessness because not only have you got that the ruling class who are saying, well, we're above the law, although they wouldn't quite say that. I think that the Queen on the royals.gov website, it was written down the Queen is actually above the law. And when people questioned that, it wasn't so much, oh, the Queen isn't above the law, they just kind of took it down and didn't mention it anymore. But if you can imagine, if the Queen can't actually be taken to her own courts, kind of thing, so she is in all effect above the law as far as statutes are concerned, and as far as the moral law is concerned, well. The people who do taxing and stealing people, taking people's cars without their consent and throwing people out of their houses and taking away people's children and stuff like that. The people who are doing that are basically blaming the Queen, saying, well, she says we can do it, kind of thing. So as far as the moral law is concerned, then how do you hold the Queen to account for that? If indeed she is to blame for all the people who are saying it's because she said they can do it, kind of thing. So it kind of breeds lawlessness in the sense that there's a whole bunch of people who now do things in the line of duty to the ruling class who are now kind of breaching the moral law as well. But more than this, because of these kind of breaches in the moral law being committed by the ruling class, by the agents of the ruling class, What you've got is a bunch of people who end up worse off than what they would have been, and because of that kind of like these sort of things are bound to return. So people will kind of, they'll either return or they'll roll downhill. So if someone is having like money stolen from them by the system, by the ruling class and by the agents of the ruling class, some people might try and get that money back from the system by stealing it back kind of thing, or some people might see that, well, the system's too strong, so they might steal it from people who are less strong than themselves kind of thing, so that the weaker and the more vulnerable and the more innocent end up being afflicted by people who are lawless, acknowledged to be so by both the moral law and the people who are claiming to be protecting the moral law in the name of the ruling class, who are really exempting themselves from the moral law and doing what they please kind of thing. So as far as the lawlessness of anarchy is concerned, like, it's only lawless to the extent that you only consider law to be whatever the ruling class say is the law. If you only accept like the law to be what the statutes say, then yeah, it's definitely, there wouldn't be any statutes, but there would still be that kind of like moral law thing, and there wouldn't be anyone exempt from it. Everybody would be equal before the law, rather than just like some people being exempt from it because the ruling class wrote down a bit of paper, well, we're allowed to threaten you if you don't, we can threaten you, we can fine you, we can throw you in a cage, we can kill you if you resist the cage, if you don't hand over whatever percentage of the fruits of your labour we demand from you, and if you do that, that's called extortion, and if we do it, it's called tax, and it's perfectly lawful for us to do that. It's either a moral or it's not a moral, and if everybody's equal before the law, then it's against the law for them to do that. As much as it is for everybody else, but if you limit the definition of law to just be whatever the government says, then of course it's perfectly lawful to do activities which is perfectly unlawful for everybody else, but you can't get away from the fact that they are declaring themselves to be above the law. I just need to check the time in this video in case I run out of clip again. So I'm at 22:37, so I've got another 8 minutes to finish off what I'm talking about here. So the other kind of thing is like anarchy is, it's not just lawlessness, but it's also chaos. So as far as like lawlessness is concerned, I would kind of throw that back and say that, well, actually it's these guys who are being lawless, kind of making up the law as they go along and excusing themselves from what was traditionally the law. I'll come on to the chaos in a bit. Traditionally, law has been about rights, and it's the kind of like empires, or like rights as in like, I'm not going to take your property from you because, like, against your consent, because when I do that, I risk that you might retaliate. This is the way I rationalise how law arose kind of thing, why it is that we're not running about like animals, like killing each other. And it's not because of some government threatening us if we're going to behave like that kind of thing. It's just unnatural. There's places where I could get away with doing things, but I don't. Because, well, I don't know, I'm still trying to suss out a rational basis for morality, and I haven't quite found it, and this is maybe the best that I can do, and maybe it's because, right, if I steal your property, then perhaps you're going to retaliate, and the more I engaged in that kind of lawless, morally lawless life, the chances of me like being harmed and is going to be like far more kind of thing. But I do recognise that if I become very good at robbing and stealing and stuff like that, I could even aspire to the point where I could create a system of governance to rob entire populations of people on a territory kind of thing. But in general, most people are being acting lawfully, regardless of whether they get caught or whether they get away from it, because intrinsically they realise that it's not a very safe way to live. And that's why I would say, in an anarchist society, we're still to get to the chaos bit with regards to the anarchy thing. I probably need to go into another part of this video to explain it. So I'm not entirely in favour of let's go into an anarchist society, which I'll explain in a bit. But it's as far as the lawlessness thing is concerned, I think people have plenty of opportunity to be morally lawless, to be immoral, but they don't need the government cajoling them, because there's just a natural instinct to do so. But traditionally, I would think that's what the law is, just basically people trying to get along with each other, and the way it seems, the way to behave kind of thing. You know, you don't want to have like conflict in your life, you want to avoid it, so you don't do things unless you're in a situation of complete duress, you know, and you're kind of forced to do extreme things, which is not something that occurs very often kind of thing. But well, traditionally I would reckon, anciently I reckon that's how the law would arose. I'll just check the time on this again. 26 minutes. It times out at half an hour, and I don't actually have another clock to see how the running time is, which is something I need to fix. Maybe I should use my other mobile phone to time it, but it means using the other battery, which I like to keep charged for emergency. So anciently I think that's how the law arose, but let's look at the more traditional perspective in what law is before this whole kind of like it's now a stramash between the moral law and the statutory law, and it's all just called law kind of thing. And probably the best example of that is in the phrase ignorance of the law is no excuse, which actually comes from two different meaning Latin phrases, which the first being ignorantia juris non excusat, and the second being ignorantia legis neminem excusat. And these things mean two slightly different things, and it's all just been combined into one thing, saying ignorance of the law is no excuse. So what it actually, what these phrases, I'll go on to another video, we'll do a phrase entitled ignorantia, and I'll stop this video and go on to kind of part two, but we'll see a new video entirely.